Hello, welcome back to Kiersti's virtual classroom. Today we are talking about faults and folds. So let's get right into it. All right, so the first thing we need to talk about is stress. So stress is the amount of force per area put on a particular object. And under stress, rocks can change shape. So depending on the type of stress, the amount of stress is applied to the rocks. They can either bend to accommodate that stress or they can break. So let's talk about the three different types of stress. So we have compression, tension, and shear. So I alluded to these when we talked about plate tectonics or tectonic boundaries. So compression is the coming together or pushing together, tension is pulling apart, and shear is sliding past. So the compression would be like a convergent plate boundary. The tension happens at a divergent plate boundary, and the shear occurs at a transform plate boundary. So we'll talk about how the different types of faults will also associate with these different types of stresses. So under that stress, the rocks, like I said, can either bend or they can break. So depending on the rock composition and the type of stress they are under, they will experience a different type of accommodation to that stress. So like I said, they're either going to bend to accommodate or break to accommodate. And there are different terms that we use for that. So ductile would be the bending. So this would be like putting Play-Doh between two geology textbooks. And the brittle is the breaking of the rocks, which would be like dropping a plate. The way I try to help students remember the difference between the terms brittle and ductile is to say that brittle is like peanut brittle. It's when you drop it's going to break, right? It's not going to bend. So if you remember that, you'll remember brittle versus ductile. Ductile will be like dough between two geology textbooks, so it bends. All right, so if it bends due to the stress, the rock layers will often fold. And yes, this is me from way back in the day looking at an overturned fold with another master's geology student. And this is when we start to assume some different things. So we assume that layers of rock are laid down horizontally before they are experiencing stress. So once they experience stress, we start to see them either bend in a fold or they start to break in a fault. So the bending is the ductile deformation, and that creates our folds. Okay, so if you see something like this in the field where the layers aren't horizontal, then you know that something has occurred here. Something after deposition of the rock. All right, so there's a couple of different types of folds that we will see. There is syncline and anticline. Syncline is a concave up fold. So you see this sort of concave up feature in the rocks here. That is a syncline. One of the ways you can remember the recognition of a syncline versus an anticline is that if you can fit a big S in it's a syncline. So synclines are always concave up, whereas anticlines are always concave down. So here you can see these rocks are folded, but they are concave down. And oftentimes they're found together. This one, the syncline that I showed you, is over a very large area. This is actually called Rainbow Basin. It's near Barstow in California. It's a really popular area for geologists to go map, so I've been there plenty of times. But it's got this huge, beautiful syncline right in the center of where the parking lot kind of is. And not all of them are that vast. When they're on smaller scales, like this anticline kind of is, you start to see synclines being accompanied because they're just waves in the rocks. The rock is bending and kind of waving. And so you do see a syncline a little bit over here where it's a concave up. But the anticlines are concave down. Another way you can remember it is if you can fit the point of an A into it, then it's an anticline. Okay. Moving on to faults. Faults are when the rocks actually break. So this is the brittle deformation. They're breaking along these points in which they can no longer hold themselves together and they shift. And it creates what we call offset. The offset can be vertical or it can be horizontal. If it's vertical, we need to look at it in a cross section. So you remember with topographic maps, we talked about cutting a mountain in half and kind of looking at the side view of it. That's what's being done here. This is actually a road cut. It's called the Charlie Brown Road Cut, actually, in California. It's near Death Valley. And you can actually see the very distinctive fault running through these layers because they have had to cut the road or cut the mountain for the road to be built. And so whenever you see part of a mountain cut open, basically, for a road. We call them road cuts. And they're really cool for geologists because it's right next to a road where we can see something happening as they cut into the mountain. So if it's moving vertically, we need a road cut or something, some, you know, slice into the mountain that we can see. But if it's a horizontal offset, we can look at that in map view, so from the top down. All right, so with faults, we have three different basic types. We have normal, reverse, strike slip. And we have three basic types because we have three different types of stress that can occur. So depending on the stress, it'll yield a different type of fault. So with normal and reverse faults, we're going to need a little bit of background information. We need to know something about where the footwall block is and the hanging wall block. The way that you kind of can distinguish whether you've got a hanging wall block or a footwall block is not always like the right side and the left side necessarily, because it changes. So depending on the angle of this fault, if it was pointed the other direction, this would then no longer be the footwall block. It would be the hanging wall block. So the way that you can figure this out is to pretend you are a miner, like I mine things, not like you're underage, you're a miner, looking for ores. And a lot of ore, which is where we would mine for minerals, will happen along the veins where there's a crack in the rock. So a lot of that is going to be in faults. And so that's how we discovered a lot of these faults too, is by looking at different mines, underground mines, and kind of investigating, and we get to see kind of inside the mountain that way. And so if you imagine a miner walking through a mine shaft, you can obviously assume that he's going to hang his lantern on the ceiling, and wherever he would hang his lantern would be considered the hanging wall block, or maybe where his head would be, we can also call it the head wall block. And then wherever his feet are planted are going to be the foot wall block. So I'll show you how we use that, or how I will use it in our examples in a minute, and I have a special fun name for him to help you remember. But that would be for just the normal and the reverse faults. For the strike slip, the left and the right lateral, we'll do a different technique where we will look at offset features in a map view fashion. Okay, so for normal faults, we have, they are being caused from tension. So here things are being pulled apart and one of the blocks drops down. So a way that you can remember the difference between the normal and the reverse is by taking your hands and putting one on top of the other. It doesn't matter which one you put on top of the other one, it's gonna do the same thing. So if you pull them apart, which hand slides down in relation to the other one? Should be your top hand. Doesn't matter if it's my right hand or my left hand, but the one on the top always slides down. So here, the hanging wall always moves down. So you can see kind of in this diagram, this is the hanging wall, and this is the one that's technically on top, and it slides down, and the foot wall moves up. Okay, so that's kind of how you can remember this guy. So in the field, this is what you would look at. You would see these rocks, some layers. How do I find the fault here? So the first step you want to do is find something called a marker bed. So, you know, like a marker you write with, but a bed, not like a bed you sleep in, a bed of rocks. So you want to find a marker bed. So something that tells you that it is no longer continuous laterally and has been offset by a fault. So here we will use this black bed. So these rocks here have been offset by whatever this line is here. So this is a fault. Hopefully you could identify that there. You can see there is not a continuation of these layers. They are truncated by this line. And so this would be your marker bed that you would use to distinguish where the fault is and what type of fault it is. So the first step is to find your fault. There it is. You've noticed that over here on the left, it's moved down, and on the right, it's moved up. Well, the next step is to try to figure out which one's the hanging wall and which one's the footwall. So I like to bring in my little guy, Homer. That's what I named him. So I draw Homer, and he stands in front of all my faults, and he tells me where the head wall is and where the foot wall is. So where his feet are planted is my foot wall, and where his head is the hanging wall or the head wall. Okay, so we can label that now, hanging wall, head wall, and our foot wall. So now we use another acronym based on the movement of here, movement of the blocks. So the foot wall block is moving up in relation to the hanging wall. So to remember that this is a normal fault, you say foot wall up normal or fun. So the acronym FUN will help you remember that the foot wall up here is a normal fault. Okay, so the footwall moves up, the hangwall moves down. Okay. When we have a series of normal faults and they are alternated in which direction the fault is inclined, whether it's inclined to the west or inclined to the east, if they alternate through a landscape, you will get something called a horst and a graben landscape. So this is the basin and range as you move from the eastern Sierra Nevada through Nevada and Utah. We get through something called the basin and range, where we have a series of basins and ranges, or in this term, the geology term is horst and graben, and that is from the series of normal faults that extend from the eastern Sierra Nevada all the way through Nevada, or sorry, yes, eastern Sierra Nevada into Nevada and Utah. And the horst is the upper portion, and the graben is the downdrop portion. So the graben will form from two normal faults that incline towards each other, or sorry, away from each other, and it'll downdrop that block because that block is the hanging wall block for both of those faults. So if you drew Homer over this fault, this is the hanging wall block, and if you drew Homer here, this is also the hanging wall block. And remember, in normal faults, the hanging wall block drops down. And so your graben will drop down. Whereas your horst is where you have two normal faults that angle towards each other, and that will bring that block up. So this would be the footwall block for both of these faults. If you drew Homer here, this would be the footwall block. Drew Homer here, this is the footwall block. And so you get this elevated piece that is the footwall block for both of those faults being uplifted. Okay, so then you'll see the older rocks at the ridges, and then you'll have younger stuff towards the middle in the grabens where material has kind of collected. So these ridges here, which are the horsts, will have the older rocks, and the younger rocks will be down here in the sediment collected basin, which is the graben. So like I said, Sierra Nevada is part of that system, or part of one of those systems on Earth. And if you go to the east side of the Sierra Nevada, this is what you will see. It's beautiful over there. It's much prettier to look at than from our side. Our side's a little bit jaded by the smog, but they have a very high relief on that side. So it's much steeper here because of the normal fault. And the Sierra Nevada is one of those horsts, and the Owens Valley, which is the valley on the east side of the Sierra Nevada, is the graben that has been downdropped. All right, moving on to reverse faults. This is formed from compression. So this is when rocks are being slammed against each other. And so again, if you take your hands and push them together, what happens? Which one moves up? Doesn't matter which hand I use. The hanging wall always moves up if I push my hands together. The top hand always moves up, right? So in compression, the rocks will respond in that the hanging wall will always move up, and it forms the reverse fault. So if we look at this in the field, hopefully you can find the marker bed. Take a second. Can you find the marker bed? Hopefully you can see that right here. This black line is a good marker bed, and they've been offset here. So it's a little bit more tricky than the one before. If we didn't have this black marker bed, it would be hard to tell kind of in here. But you see the fault there. On the left side here, it's moved up, and on the right, it's moved down. Let's bring in Homer. Now we can label our hanging wall and our foot wall. Remember where his feet are, this is our foot wall block. And where his head is our hanging wall. Okay, there's our hanging wall, our head wall, and our foot wall. So here the hanging wall is moving up, and the foot wall is moving down, creating a reverse fault. The acronym to remember here would be HER, head wall up, reverse. So H-U-R, not her, like H-E-R. So fun and her. If you remember fun and her, footwall up normal and headwall up reverse, and you should be good to go. All you need to do is be able to recognize where the hanging wall and the footwall are, and you should be okay. Moving on to strike slip faults. Remember, these we look down in map view. So we're going to look from basically the sky down to the earth on these. We're not looking at a cross section or a cut open mountain. So here they are moving horizontally, and so you see horizontal offset. In the previous two, you see vertical offset, right? These are caused from shear stress, so they're sliding past each other, and we have a right and a left lateral. The easiest way to do this is to figure out, or to figure out which one you're looking at, right or left, is to use a surface feature. So you want to find a feature that has been offset that is continuous across the fault. So this example will be a road. So let's say that we are driving down a road and we're in this left one here, this one on the left, excuse me, and you're in the red car. Okay, you're driving down the road and you get to the fault. If you are aligned parallel to the feature that is offset, so that would be the road, perpendicular to the fault, which direction do you need to turn at the fault in order to get to the rest of the road? You would have to turn right. So that makes it a right lateral strike slip fault. Even if you were in the blue car, if you align yourself with the blue car, you're parallel to this feature and you're perpendicular to the fault, you have to turn right still to get to the rest of the road. Whereas in this diagram over here on the right, if you're in this red car, you're aligning yourself parallel to the road, perpendicular to the fault. When you get to the fault, you have to turn left. Same thing with this blue car. You get to the fault on the road, perpendicular to the fault, you have to turn left still. Okay? So that's what helps you distinguish whether you're looking at a right lateral or a left lateral fault. Okay, so here's another example. This one actually moves. So if you aligned yourself parallel to the offset surface feature, so you're parallel to the offset surface feature, perpendicular to the fault, okay, so you're perpendicular to the fault, which direction is the rest of your surface feature? Doesn't matter if it's a road, it could be a fence, it could be a house. Which direction is it moving? Is it moving to the left or moving to the right? So in this image, it is moving to the left. So this little GIF here, this little animation, is a left lateral strike slip fault. California, we have a very famous strike slip fault, which is the San Andreas Fault. It causes all of our problems in California as far as earthquakes are concerned. We do have a few other faults that are been kind of popping up here and there, but this is the major hitter in California, especially in the Bay Area and LA. And this is a, well, I'll let you try. So we've got a couple of offset features here. We have a fence and we have a stream. So if you line yourself parallel to the stream or parallel to the fence, and you're perpendicular to the fault that's running through here and the fault that's running through here, cutting it in half, which direction is the rest of the stream or the rest of the fence? So take a second. I'll give you a minute. You can pause the video if you'd like. Okay, so if you align yourself parallel to that surface feature, so let's say the fence, and you're standing right here facing this direction, the rest of the fence is to the right. We stand along the stream, parallel to the stream, perpendicular to the fault. The rest of the stream is on the right. So this is a right lateral strike slip fault. Okay, and just to sum up to review, we have the dip slips and the strike slips. So the normal and the reverse fault are referred to as dip slip faults because they move up and down, or they move vertically. And then our strike slips move horizontally. So normal fault is from tension. Remember, when you pull apart, the hanging wall moves down. Reverse faults are from compression. So this occurs when rocks are pushed together and the hanging wall moves up. And then strike slip, the blocks move laterally or side by side. So you have the right and the left lateral. And that's it for faults and folds. We'll move into earthquakes in the next video, and I will see you guys there. Bye!